Just to be sure you're in the right class. That's me. The GH is silent. We normally would be meeting on the Greenbrier camp, no, Raleigh campus, room 134. And I couldn't justify just chopping this day out of our calendar because things are kind of tight as it is, getting everything done before the end of the semester. So I figured I'd just use the COVID version of our course. I had to teach all my courses this way when the COVID panic set in. So, let's see where to start. Is everybody familiar with Brightspace? How to navigate Brightspace? Anybody not familiar with Brightspace? So I assume you can find the course, otherwise you probably wouldn't make the connection. So I can start. Let me start by sharing the Brightspace course, and I'll just hit some salient points first and some requirements. Put it that way. Let's see. Where is it? No, that's not it. That's not it. Well, I can't find my. Oh, there it is. I had to find my browser. Okay. Excuse me. Let me go back. Let's see. Close that window. Close this window. Here we go. So this is what the landing page of Chem 101 would look like. And this is one thing that the management wanted me to emphasize to some students. If you've already made a payment on your tuition, then you're probably in good shape. If you haven't, then I'm supposed to let you know that the drop for non-payment date is the 22nd, so next Monday. And you need at least $200 on your account to stay current. If there's, and if you follow this video, control click that link, then somebody from the business office is giving you more detail about what's expected to stay current with your account. Let's see. So, everybody familiar? Does everybody know what the mini bar is right here? See the mini bar? They call it a mini bar. I think it's funny. I'll point out some salient tabs. Assignments here. All you're going to find in assignments for this class are the extra credits. This is Chem 101, the lecture class. We're also going to do 103 as soon as we get finished with this and get you ready for the lab. So we have several extra credits. This is a major item here, getting to know your periodic table and 50 ways to name your compound. And they're both due on the same date because they're embedded in the same unit. Right. I'll talk about that more when we get to that point. Also, I've got extra credits for each of the chapters in the forms of crosswords. These crossword puzzles, I guess I could say, force you to get words that are important for that chapter's material and make them fit in the crossword. And when we get into the course, I'll show you where they are and how to submit them. But as far as the value goes, the these two, getting to know your periodic table and 50 ways to name your compound, when you take those percent grades and put them together, average them together, that's worth a half an exam. So it's pretty substantial. The crosswords, if we take at the end of the semester, if I take all your crossword puzzles, and you don't have to do them if you don't want to, that's why they're extra credit. But if we take all the values that you get for these, the scores that you get for the crosswords, and average them together, that's an exam grade. So that's, you got an exam and a half there in extra credits that can help you out. Okay, that's assignments. You know about the class list. This shows you everybody that's in the class. If you want to email individuals or email the whole class, just click on that and then send an email. That way you don't have to look up everybody in the directory. And this is the way I'll be communicating with you. If I need to send an email, I'll come in here and it'll go to your New River email account. So if you're accustomed to using your personal email accounts for everything, I'd advise you to most email clients will allow you to link to at least two email accounts in that client. That's usually the limit on free versions. If you have paid versions, then you can do unlimited. But I have two email clients and I have two accounts linked in each one. And they're in my phone. So if you email me here, I'll get it on my phone and respond fairly quickly. Okay, let's skip that one for, I'll come back to that. Let's see, it's grades. I think I better, let me make myself a student so it'll look like what you're expecting to see. So if we go into grades, this will show you all the grades. Here are all the tests. Here are all the homeworks, and here are the extra credits. These reviews are Brightspace exams, but they're not graded for me. They're graded for you. So you can go in here and you can and do one of these reviews. It'll grade it, show you which ones are wrong. You can focus your attention on the wrong ones, and you can go back, take it again, take it as many times as you want. So this is for you to drill if you are so inclined. Crosswords are, and these are all extra credits. The homework is through Cengage, and that's why you have to buy Cengage Unlimited. That gives you the textbook and it gives you access to the homework. So I'll say more about that later. And these are all the exams. I'll point out that this practice test for Respondus, I want you to take the practice test, and the whatever grade you get is irrelevant. It's just to check out your equipment and for you to be sure that your equipment's going to work for the first graded exam. So you don't have to go in here blind with your exams. And the first exam won't open until the practice test is done. So once you do the practice test, Exam one will become available. Okay. Let's see. Grades, quizzes. You can get to the Zoom from there. So there are all your the Zoom classes. Here's today. Just click on it, you're in. Okay, so let's go back to content. Content is where the meat of the course is located. I think some of your instructors maybe will add an item up here called Start Here, right? But for me, I just left it content. Go into content, and this will give you if what's going to come up is the last time you were in here, it's going to show you that page. So if you want to get start new, just tick on, click on Table of Contents, and now you're fresh to go again. I like to start, let's start here. Cengage OWL homework registration. You need to register for the Cengage homework from within Brightspace because the Cengage, the OWL is the name of the homework. OWL recognizes you as enrolled in the course when you come to it from within Brightspace. So it's all linked. If you try to register for Cengage outside of Brightspace, then I won't see you as completing homework in the course. So it's important that you do this. There's a contact again. Is click on this, and since it thinks I'm a student, it's going to try to force me to register eventually. Yeah, so if you've already registered for a Cengage course with another class, then and paid for the semester or for the year, then you don't have to pay for it again. You just come in here and it'll ask you to register. You may need your actually, I think what you have to do is just log in. If you're already registered with Cengage with an active account, you just log in, and then it'll take you straight to homework for this course. All right, so I'm going to close that because I can't go any farther. Let's see. You notice the breadcrumbs at the top. You can go backwards. Sometimes it shows you breadcrumbs. So there's Cengage homework. These are Cengage has a whole month of from here in January to the middle of February. They've got a whole month of office hours set up for students. So Monday, Wednesday, and Friday on these hours, and Tuesday, Thursday at those hours, you just click on the link right here. And if you're having trouble with Cengage registering, or later on, if you're having technical difficulties in the first month, you click on that, and there'll be some tech support sitting there waiting for you. And hopefully iron out the problem. If it's later after February, and you have a problem, and you can either contact me and I can try to fix it, or if you try to contact Cengage tech support, let's see, I'm not sure where their number is, but if you can't get satisfaction from them, go to this guy, John Sale, and his job is to rattle our cage for us. Okay. So, all of the documents in this course are in PDF format. So you're going to need an Acrobat reader. So if you don't already have one, just click on this one, and I try Adobe Acrobat Reader first. Download a free version, and that way you can open all the PDF files that I distribute. If we were having this course face to face today, I'd have a whole bunch of handouts for you. They'd be all printed out and ready to go. And I'll have them ready for the next time we meet so we can catch up. If you just want to go in to Brightspace and look at documents, you can print your copies if you want, but I'll hand out hard copies the next time we meet. Save ink from your printer. This is the, let me make sure it's the right one, 20961. Yeah, this is the course schedule. I extracted this from the syllabus and put it in here as a separate item so that you wouldn't have to go look into the syllabus to find it if you just want to find out what the schedule is. All right, so we'll talk about the schedule again in a minute. I'll come back to the syllabus. Let's see. Supplemental Zoom class. Let's see, where's the. I may have put it in Module 1. Well, there's a link to the class meeting, right? You can get the Zoom meeting there. So let me look at Module 1. I think I may have put it in here. Let's see. You can collapse everything, it gets too busy. I was looking for the practice test. No, that's not the one. What did I do with it? No, not the practice tests. All right, that's for That's for module one. Okay, I'm a student. Maybe I've hidden it. Let me take a quick. Let me go out here and come back in because that's important. You can't get to exam one. Well, face to face, you're going to have a paper exam, right? That's no problem. But if for some reason you need to take the exam in Brightspace, then you need access. No. Well, I'm not sure where it is. Wait a minute. Maybe it's in here. There it is. Okay, so in the exam one module, in exam one under module one, there's your practice test. If you're going to take an exam in Brightspace, which you may not do that, right? You may take face to face the whole semester. But if you do have to go in and do an exam in Brightspace, you need to run this practice test first. So let me see. Doesn't look like it's hidden. Let me be sure. No, it should be available. Okay. We'll come back to that in a second. So let me go back and be a student again. All right. I'm going to eat up too much time, I'm afraid. One thing you'll notice is if you're going to take an exam face to face, you'll have the exam, and then the last few pages will be useful information. Stuff that I don't expect you to memorize. You can memorize it if you want, but useful information. And if you take it in Brightspace and go into lockdown browser, it's not going to let you open any other documents. So before you go into the exam, be sure and print a copy of this useful information right there. Okay. Be sure and print a copy of it. And then when you get into lockdown browser, if that's the way you're going, then you'll have that available. Okay, let me go back. Let's see. Let's go back to the syllabus now. Okay, there's my syllabus PDF format. I know it's long, it's 16 pages, but I encourage you to treat it as if it were a contract. Now, if you're going to sign a contract for, say, a loan or for some services to be provided, you're going to read it, even the fine print. So consider the syllabus a contract. It's something you ought to read from cover to cover. I'll point out some highlights as we go through. And all the syllabi this semester should look alike. They should look exactly like this in all your courses. That hasn't always been the case. My contact information, let's see. Right, there's face to face. Oh, wait a minute. Office hours here. I'll show you. Office hours are also, I've got a schedule, my class schedule, so I can show you where I am, when I am. Let's see. I'll call your attention here to the class times and location textbook. If you're going to take the second semester in sequence, then buying Cengage Unlimited for a year is probably a better deal. If you've already bought it for a semester, then it'll only take you through this semester, and then you'll have to buy it again for the next time you take the course. If you're not sure about taking the second semester, or you're not going to, then obviously one semester's better. And then again, if you've already bought it for another course, you don't have to buy it again. If you want a hard copy, the Cengage Unlimited gives you an electronic copy of the textbook. If you want a hard copy, these are the particulars. So you can go out anywhere, Amazon. You can buy an earlier version if you want, ninth edition, eighth edition. Or you can contact Cengage and they'll send you a hard copy loaner for shipping charges like $4, I think. Okay, you can read those at your leisure. Grading scheme, that's important. All the chapter exams together account for 57% of your grade. The final exam accounts for 13%, which is basically two chapter exams. The homework is 20% of your grade. And for showing up and participating in the class, I give you 10%. So I'm hoping that'll incentivize most people to show up for class one way or another, either in person or by Zoom. I'll just say this. If you can't get to class and you can Zoom, then that's better than nothing. But if you're signed up for the lab, and I think most everybody is signed up for the lab, to do the lab, you've got to show up in person. Right? This is not a virtual lab. This is hands-on. So if we have a lab, and the schedule will show you whether we have a lab on that day or not. We don't have labs every day that they're on the schedule. And I'll talk to you about that in just a second. There are penalties for late exams, late homework. There are no penalties for extra credits. This is stuff I have to put in there. You can read that as your at your leisure. Course materials. If you don't already have a scientific calculator, get one. I think you can get one at Walmart for 10 bucks. I don't know, with the inflation, maybe it's 15 by now. But if the package says scientific on it, you've got all the functions you need. Everything else I supply. It's either in Brightspace or I'll hand you hard copies. That's just an outline. This is how regular exams will go. Homework, there's some more details about the homework. I'll just reemphasize the fact that you need to register your you'll get a when you buy Cengage Unlimited, you'll get an authorization code. So when you go through Brightspace into Cengage to register, don't do it any other way. Bonus and extra credit. All right. The only thing I'm going to say about bonus and extra credit is I've shown you all the bonus and extra credit that you're going to get. There are bonus questions on the exams, right? So that's another avenue to rake in some points. I have had students that at the end of the semester, I would be willing to bet that based upon their exam grades, they don't have a clue. And they're coming back to me asking for extra credit. What can I do to pass the course? And I don't want to be catty about it, but if you want to know chemistry, pass the exams. The extra credits are there to help. But at that point, if you can, you better drop and come back later. So don't ask me for any extra assignments, any special assignments. I don't do that. Okay, so here's the schedule again. And you'll notice that I've got activities, and here are the chapters that we're going to cover with those activities. And then on the side, I found it useful because nearly all of my students are signed up for 103. Lab. Also, I put the labs out here on the right. That helps me too to know where I am and what I'm doing, when I'm supposed to be there. So these are not requirements for the course. They're just to show you what we're doing in the lab on the schedule. Okay, so for today, we've got class business, and we're gonna look at chapter one, and then we're gonna go in and take a look at requirements and expectations for the lab. Let's see. Okay. So I got the lecture here, last day to add drop. Sometimes I put these administrative information here for you too, so that you won't miss a date. And then we have lecture, chapter one and two, and then we have a whole day set aside for reviews. The reviews are usually when I have labs, because we'll get those done, and then we can go in the lab with no overrun. And then homework is due. Exam one is due on this day, Thursday the 25th. That's your first exam. And I've highlighted them so they'll stand out, and you can see that I got something coming. And notice that I usually don't have labs on the same day as exams. Especially when we've got a shortened version. If we meet twice a week, then we've really only got time for one exam on that day. If we have, well, on Thursday, there's no lab anyway. Tuesdays, okay, here's a Tuesday that has an exam. There's no lab because I want to give you plenty of time to do the exam. Here's another Tuesday. That lecture we cover, no lab. What I'm trying to do is to, my history, knowing how far overrun I'm going to be, maybe we better not have a lab on that day because I'm going to use up that lab time to finish the lecture. I do that very often. Okay, so there's the spring break, and there's when the mid-semester grades are due, and then we have final grades due on that date. So this gives you, unless there are extenuating circumstances, you can expect that these are hard and fast, chiseled in stone dates to keep you paced in the course and keep me on track too. Notice occasionally I build in a buffer day, right? So if I don't finish the lecture in these a lot of times, we may run over to this day. And then in this case, we finish the lecture and then have a lab. All right. So there's the schedule. Academic integrity, right? Most of my students know better than to cheat. I think it's more work to cheat than it is to learn the material. That's just me. I got a little blurb on artificial intelligence. That won't be a real problem in to consider in the lecture course, but in the lab where you have to write formal reports, you may be tempted to use artificial intelligence. I'm not saying you can't, right? You can use AI to generate a paragraph, say, on a topic you want. But I'd advise you to go back and read it because AI is not fully developed yet, and it can just fabricate things, just pull things out of the blue and make stuff up, right? They've even found some AI programs to have psychoses. So just a word of caution there. Attendance policy for New River, right? I will record attendance in DropGuard, which is the application that we use to track student attendance and to try to head problems off before they get too serious. So I'll record attendance there, and if you have an excused absence, I'll record it as such. But for the course, my course policy is there's no such thing as an excused absence. I give you credit for showing up. So if you don't show up, you just don't get that credit. I would advise trying to make every class you can at the beginning of the semester. And if you zoom in, you're attending. But if you're gone, whether it's excused or not, then your name's not on the sign-in sheet, and you don't get credit for that day in that 10% slot. Makeup testing. Our schedule is so tight, makeup testing is doable, and we can set up special times to do the test, but it may be more convenient if for some reason you can't make it to the exam date, that I give you permission to take the exam in Brightspace. And I need to know in advance so that I can open that exam up for you, because it's restricted at this point. And only when I say you can take the Brightspace exam. If you encounter in a test a place where you think you gave the right answer and it marked you wrong, or I marked you wrong, then these are instructions on how to get that corrected. Now, what I'll do is I'll look at the question that you missed and see if there's something wrong with the question or wrong with the key. Right? Sometimes my key is wrong and I graded you wrong and it should have been right. Right? And if that's the case, I'll certainly give you credit for it. My motto is students do not suffer for my mistakes. Exam etiquette, you can read that at your leisure. Everybody knows how to behave during an exam. I got some tips here on how to be successful, low stress, minimize stress, communication with me outside the class. This is how you get in touch with me during the office hours. And there's my the ID for the Zoom meeting. My Zoom meetings don't have a passcode for my office hours, right? The courses, the Zoom classes, they do have passcodes just to keep outsiders from coming in and bombing us. But I'll show you my office hours in a minute. And if you connect with me during my office hours, you can do it in person on two of the days. And Mondays, though, are Zoom only. So you can either connect with this link right here, or if you want to connect on your phone, you just need to load the Zoom app on your phone, and you can find that in the App Store, whichever type of phone you have. And once you've got it loaded, all you need is to call it up and use this code. You can do that for the Zooming the meetings too, the class meetings, with your phone or tablet. You can either use the link that's in Brightspace, or you can Zoom in this way if you don't have access to the class on your phone. Appendix one, this talks about homework. I'm gonna let you look at that and ask questions later. This appendix two is about taking a test in using Respondus Monitor and Lockdown Browser if in the event that you have to do it that way. If you have to take an exam using Lockdown Browser, Respondus Monitor is going to be watching you. So you need to dress appropriately and take account of all your surroundings as if you were sitting in the classroom. Right, so don't take the test in bed. Sit up at a desk and in a room where you won't be distracted. You don't have small animals or small children running around. Just treat it as if you were in the classroom. Let's see. That's more about taking a Brightspace exam. It'll be irrelevant unless you do it that way. If you attend class, there's some more notes about attending class with Zoom. Here's the ID and the passcode, or you can cut and paste this right here. There's several places where that occurs, so that you can attend class in Zoom if you're forced to do it that way. Okay, I've been talking a while. Stop me if you got any questions. Otherwise, I'll go back to the syllabus folder, and here's my schedule. I have that in a handout that I'll give you, and I have copies of these on my office door also. If you lose your copy, you can snag one out of that folder. So here we are. We have lab today, and we don't have one on Thursday. This block of time is office hours from 3 o'clock to 6 o'clock, and this is Zoom only. So I usually Zoom those from home. This is in person or Zoom during this time slot, 8:30 to 11:30, and this slot from 2:30 to 4:30. Any of these times I'm in classes, and on Fridays I'm out of town, so you won't find me in my office on Fridays. In fact, I'm tied up with two classes at Southern West Virginia Community College in Logan, teaching those classes. So that tells you where I am, when I am. All right. And one other thing, let's see. This is just a link for office hours. All right, so that's another way to connect. Right, so you just open the Zoom meeting. If we, during those office hours, or if those office hours don't match your schedule, like if you work or you have other obligations and you need some help, then contact me either on my office phone, by email, or text me on my cell phone, and we can set up a meeting whenever it's convenient for you and I don't have a conflict. And office out, they'll always be at this link. Okay. Let's go back to start here. And let's see. Let's go into one of the modules. There is a final exam. I don't know if I mentioned that, but there is comprehensive final. There's a module. And what I've added, I added this toward the end of last semester, is a checklist, right? So if you want to know what to do for module one, right, you need to memorize symbols, learn these elements, and I'll show you where that is. Memorize chemical symbols for the elements, not the whole periodic table, right? I'll show you which ones, about half of them. Read the text, either come to class or view the video lecture. There's your homework. There's text for chapter two. Same, same, same. Then we have review, right? So when it says view the video, you'll usually be in class for that. And then you have extra credits. All right, so you have extra credit here, 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 and here. Lots of extra credits for the first module. And then the exam. And that's your whole checklist. If you get all those things done, then you know you haven't missed anything. Okay. When you get down to the, here's chapter one, PowerPoint slides, right? If you have, most people have Microsoft Office, you can open, download this PowerPoint slide set, and you'll have that on your computer if you want to look at that. You can, this is the PDF version, right? It just won't have any of the animations or the videos embedded, but this one will. This is browser language, HTML5. So if you click on this one, okay, I got to do some corrections. I think it's looking for a font that's not there, right? So give me a chance to fix that. Let's see. Okay, so let's go back to the module. And all the modules are going to be set up the same way. So there are your slide sets. I will post the video from our class. This is the last time I taught it, the video for that lecture. Right, so it's there. When I put in our current video, I'll move that one into archives. Learn these elements, right? You need to know that. I'll hand out a copy of, hard copy of that one. Uh-oh, where is, oh, here it is. PDF file. There you go. So this is a periodic table, has all the element symbols, but it doesn't have the names. You got to look those up. And the ones that I want you to memorize have red boxes around them. So there are about half of them that are that way. Now, if you haven't already memorized these from a, say, a high school course or some other course, then I found the best way to memorize them is to get 3x5 index cards and write the symbol on one side and write the name on the other. And that starts the process of memorization. When you do that, then you take the flashcards and you just drill them until you know them. Okay, so let's see. There, let's back up. learn these symbols. And there's a chapter two lecture. Here are your extra credits for periodic table. What you'll have to do for this one is either come to class and get a hard copy or download it, print it yourself. Because you have this is a periodic table that you'll need to fill out. And notice that if you do it this way, and say you want to bring your work to class and turn it in for extra credit. Say you left it at home. Well, what you can do is scan the pages and upload them here. So this one would look like that. You just download it. Right? These are instructions on how to fill it out, and here's your framework. Right? That's a periodic table with nothing in it. So finish that, and that gives you credit for that one. It's worth 407 points, and I'll go through and make comments. And actually, when I report your grade, I'll attach the graded form. If you submit it this way in Brightspace, I'll attach the graded product there. If you hand it to me in person, then I'll hand you back the graded version. Okay. Let's see. Come on. There we go. So that was one extra credit. The other extra credit is 50 ways to name your compound. That one's self-explanatory. I won't go into that. Here's your extra credit crossword puzzles. Right. You download those and fill those out, and or you get a hard copy in class. Same thing. Hand them back to me. Here's a review. Right. We have, for our review day, we have that one. Here's a homework link. Right. So you're going to have chapter one, chapter two homework. And you just click on that. And once you registered with Cengage, it'll take you directly to chapter one homework. Now you can get there by using that other, let's see, where the registration. Here we go. You can go to this one. But when you get there, you got to find the chapter. This way, it takes you straight to the chapter. These are archive videos. That's where I store all the old stuff. So I got a lot of them in there. You don't have to look at those unless you want to. And here's the exam one Brightspace version. It's not available yet because I haven't been authorized as a student, and I haven't taken the practice test. So that's all you're going to see at that point. Okay, and every module is set up the same way. External links, we'll just look at those for a second. If you want somebody else to explain something to you, right, you're not getting it the way I'm telling you about it, then Khan Academy is an excellent website. If you go to them and search for the topic that we're on, then you can get another. Most of them, most of the videos are done by Saul Khan himself, and they're very detailed and very well done, actually. Okay, I just ate up a bunch of time. Let's see. I got 30 more minutes left in 101, and then I'm going to use time in 103 time slot to finish the lecture chapter one. That, got any questions this far? Did somebody show up when I was wanting to look at? Scroll down and see. See, Meredith and Trinity, I'm looking for. Patricia. Okay, they must not have
Quick
gotten it.
question.
I'm sorry.
I
Yeah.
have a quick question.
Okay.
If we bought our book off somewhere else, like you said, like Amazon or something like that, is there ways we can get just the homework off of that Cengage? Because I looked and it wants me to buy the whole book to have access to the homework.
Well, that's why I specify Cengage Unlimited.
Yeah.
With Cengage Unlimited, you get the electronic textbook and the homework.
Yeah.
To be honest with you, I don't know. I assume all you need is a registration code, and then you can come into Brightspace and go to this registration site.
Yeah.
And then once you're there, it'll ask you for that code, and you should be able to register with it.
Where is that registration code? Do I need to call them? Is it somewhere in the book that I have, or do you not know?
It depends on the version of the book. Some books come with Cengage access to homework. Some of them don't.
Okay.
So maybe that would be a good question for the Cengage office hours. Let's see, where did I put those? Here, right here.
Yeah.
Right. That would be a good question for them.
Okay, yeah, I will check that out. Thank you.
Yeah. If you've already bought the book, then you've probably spent a lot of money on it. Did you buy it through the bookstore?
No, I found it on Amazon a lot cheaper, and I've seen a lot of my books able
Okay.
to do that, but I might just have to return it and do this through there, just spend the
Well,
extra money.
if the book was new, then the possibility that it'll have an access code.
Yeah, it was new. I'll have to look through it too and see if I can find something.
Access code is usually under the front, in the front somewhere.
Okay.
Right. It may be a separate slip of paper. But if you want to check with these people before you send it back and buy the unlimited, then that may give you a little more information knowing what to do. Okay. So let me think. Maybe before we get to the lecture, I ought to go to the, call up the lab, and we'll do some preliminary stuff with the lab, and that way you'll be sure and get it in. And then the lecture, what I tell my students is, especially if we're face to face in a Zoom class, and I'm lecturing on something, and I go long, if you have to. If you can't stay long enough to let me finish my lecture, that's fine, or review, then you go ahead because I'm recording everything anyway. And then you can catch the video that I post in Brightspace later, and you can scroll to the point where you left off and then finish it out. Or it's been my experience as a student, and experience with other students, is that you only catch about half of what you hear in class anyway. But even if you're taking good notes, you miss half of it. So in the old days, I would have a audio recorder sitting at my desk, and I go home and transcribe my notes and pick up all the stuff that I missed. Nowadays, it's nicer because we have the videos, and all the videos that I record in class, I reprocess them to get rid of dead air and correct mistakes and so forth, and then I upload them to my YouTube channel. And what you'll find in Brightspace is the link to that YouTube channel. So when you go there, unfortunately, you have to endure some commercials probably, but at least you got the video of what you had already seen in class or what you missed in class. So let me stop this share and share the PowerPoints for chapter one. Let me be sure. Yes. Chapter one is all I'm going to cover today. We'll do chapter two next Thursday. So let's see, where's my PowerPoint? Here we go. All right. Make a slideshow out of it. Here we go. Okay, chemical foundations. This is what the ninth edition looks like. So I don't know if any of you have been introduced to chemistry before, maybe in other subjects, if you've had anatomy and physiology, or if you had a biology class, He may have sprinkled you with a little chemistry. Or if you had it in high school, you had introduction to chemistry. So you have an idea of what chemistry is. Chemistry, very simple definition, and actually chemistry is a very has a broad umbrella that covers large parts of the scientific world. Chemistry is the study of substances and how they change from one substance to another. The developing an intuition about chemistry is a very long process and requiring lots of experience, but you got to start somewhere. And to understand chemistry, and this took modern scientists a couple of centuries to get a good handle on it, is when you observe changes that are occurring macroscopically, that is, that you can see with your eyes, that you can hold in your hands, you have enough of that stuff that you can see it and hold it. In order to properly explain it, you've got to make a transition from the macroscopic world to the microscopic world, the world of atoms and molecules. That's where chemistry is really happening. So, in other words, you need to learn to think on the atomic level. When you see a change happening, say in the laboratory, say you see a color change, or you see a phase change, or you see gas being evolved or something, right? I mean, that's evidence of a chemical reaction, but what is causing it? And there's something happening at the atomic level that's making it do that. So the intuition, the jump from macroscopic to microscopic is something that you always keep in the back of your mind. Okay. Atoms versus molecules, right? What's an atom? Well, an atom is the tiniest part of an element that can still retain the properties of that element. So an atom of oxygen will behave like all other atoms of oxygen, whether you have one of them or a billion of them. They will have the same physical and chemical characteristics. Whereas if we combine oxygen and hydrogen together, in the proper proportions, like two atoms of hydrogen and one atom of oxygen, you can get a water molecule. Now, we know the water molecule has different properties from either oxygen or hydrogen. First off, at room temperature, oxygen and hydrogen are gases. And at room temperature, water is a liquid. Right. So we observe those changes, and those changes are there because of what's happened at the atomic level. So an atom is a single part, smallest part of an element that is still that element. A molecule is a bound collection of atoms, two or more atoms, that act as a single unit. Now, we had an atom of oxygen and an atom of hydrogen showing on the previous slide. In this slide, what we're showing is this is how oxygen actually exists at room temperature and one atmosphere pressure. Same for hydrogen. These are known as diatomic elements. They're still elements, right? Because there's only one type of atom located here, oxygen, oxygen, or hydrogen, hydrogen. But there are two or more atoms bound together, right? So we have an oxygen molecule. So the oxygen atom is just represented by the symbol O, but an oxygen molecule has two oxygens bound together. And hopefully, as we progress through the semester, we'll explain why that happens. Why do they want to be that way? in the atmosphere that we breathe, right? Oxygen is 21% oxygen in the atmosphere. Nitrogen's the same way. This is an atom of nitrogen, but this is the way nitrogen exists in the atmosphere. It's a gas, a diatomic molecule of nitrogen, gas that we breathe. 78% of the atmosphere is nitrogen. Okay, so these are still elements, but they're also molecules. Now, what happens during a chemical reaction? During a chemical reaction, one substance changes, or actually, one or more substances together change into one or more substances as products. And they have different chemical and often physical characteristics. They are distinct. They are new substances. Water is a substance that we can identify. We can split it. Right? In the previous slides, we put them together and made water. But we can also split them. We can go back the other direction. We can split these water molecules and make oxygen molecules and hydrogen molecules. All we need is an energy source, electric current usually, will split the water. In fact, if you are a submariner, right, in the Navy, in a submarine, in a nuclear-powered submarine, and you stayed underwater for 6 months, right, you're going to wonder, how do I get oxygen to breathe? Well, they take water from the ocean, they run current through it, split it into oxygen and hydrogen. They dump the hydrogen and keep the oxygen. And that's what the submariners breathe. While they're underwater, they don't have to snorkel. They don't have to snorkel to get their oxygen. Okay, so that's an example of a chemical reaction. Notice that we have reactants on the left-hand side, products on the right-hand side, and an arrow in between. Sometimes we write the arrow going both directions. Right? We may write it like this, like that. Because very often reactions can go both directions. But for now, we're just going to use a single arrow until we get the hang of it. Okay, before we go any deeper in chemistry is a science. In other words, the Greek word that is translated science means in context either knowledge or truth, one or the other. For our purposes, we're going to settle on knowledge. The science in our modern times that we use is actually expanded definition. It's a framework that we use for gaining and organizing knowledge. And the methods that are built into science, often called the scientific method, is a way of gathering information and then making sense of it in a way that other scientists can understand. So that when you tell other people about it, either verbally, like at a conference meeting, or in written form, publication in some referee journal, then those who are receiving that information, it has a familiar form and they can understand what you're trying to do because modern science requires that your peers are privy to what you're doing and they can duplicate what you're doing in their own laboratories. That's if it's in the public domain, of course. There are proprietary situations that where those methods are guarded, but where you're allowed to publish, say you're working for a company. And they allow you to publish certain things. So the reason for peer review is to keep people honest, right? If it weren't for that, I could say I conducted this experiment and these are my results and published it, and they think I was the biggest brain on the planet. But I could be lying, right? And scientists have tried to do that. If we have time, I'll mention a couple. But being peer reviewed, you know that you have to present your information in such a way and your methods so that anybody else with enough background and enough and the right equipment can duplicate your experiment and reproduce it, right, to see if you're being honest and to disseminate the information. Because the way we advance in knowledge is to take what we've learned before from other people and add to it. And in the process, we weed out the errors and keep the truth and keep moving forward. So, with that respect, being a framework, science is the scientific method, in fact, is a plan of action. It's a procedure for processing and understanding of this information that we're gathering. So here's what the scientific method looks like in a schematic form. The process can be modified. It's that flexible. It can be modified to suit whatever field you're working in. So if I'm working in biology, I'll modify it for living systems. If I'm working in pure chemistry, I'll have a certain way of doing things. If I'm in theoretical physics or if I'm in experimental physics, I'll modify it to suit my methods. But in general, the scientific method starts with an observations. You see something that piques your curiosity in the natural world, and you want to explain how that's happening. Or better yet, eventually explain why it's happening. Well, the first thing you do is, based on what you've observed and your experience and intuition, you propose an answer to the question, right? If you want to know how it's happening, I say, well, I think it's happening this way. For instance, if I go outside and see, let's see, let's keep it simple. The sky is blue. I see this blue sky. Well, not so much today, but I see a blue sky. And I wonder what causes that sky to be blue. Well, I can propose something. I can say, I believe the sky is blue because sunlight coming from the sun impacts the atmosphere, and it's composed of a host of different wavelengths of light, and the atmosphere absorbs much of that light and scatters some of it, and what's left over is blue. Okay, so that's sort of a that's not a good hypo. There are good hypotheses and bad hypotheses. So once you've got your hypothesis, then you design an experiment to test it to see if your hypothesis is correct. Did I make a correct assumption when I proposed that hypothesis? So I conduct the experiment. And as it turns out, yes, the sky is blue because of light scattering, right? The blue wavelengths are scattered off of molecules in the upper atmosphere, and other wavelengths are either absorbed or they pass through and they're not reflected, right? So all that's left over is the blue light. Now, if that were not correct, I'd have to discount that hypothesis and make another one, an experiment. As it turns out, I'll come back to that in a minute. If we conduct experiments over and over again and we say, all right, if A, then B, every time A, always B, then we can devise a law. It's simply a summary of those repeated observations with a particular behavior as an outcome. It says nothing about why. I can't explain why things happen. But the law tells me that when I do this, I get that. For instance, I turned to Isaac Newton, and Isaac Newton's laws of motion. You may know them, may not. His Isaac Newton's first law of motion is that an object at rest tends to remain at rest unless acted upon by an external force, or an object in motion tends to remain in motion unless opposed by a force. Right? That's his first law, and that's just a simple statement. Laws can also come in the form of mathematical formulas. Newton's second law says, simply that. If I have a force applied to a mass of a given size, then I will get this acceleration every time. That's simply a law. Doesn't explain why. Now, if some bright scientist comes along and says, look at all these laws, I have an idea that I can explain why every one of those laws behaves the way it does. So he says, okay, this is why that one does that, and that one does that, and that one does that, based upon my theory. The theory always says why something happens. And very often it produces a model. A model is a representation of reality. It's not reality, it's just representation. It can be a mathematical model, it can be a physical model, like a model airplane. It's not the airplane, but it represents it. Models are good because we can take them apart and change things about them and try to put them back together and see what effect it has. The value of a theory is in its predictive power. If we make a change that the law can't handle, the theory may be able to tell us what to expect as an outcome. Right? So that's why the theories are more powerful than the laws. All right. I got a video from Monty Python, right? It was a comedy group. You may not, unless you like old television. Monty Python did this skit, and somebody annotated it for the scientific method. I think it's pretty cute.
Find the witch, may we burn her?
Burn her!
How do you know she is a witch?
She looks like one!
Bring her forward.
I'm not a witch, I'm not a witch.
What makes you think she is a witch?
Oh, she turned me into a newt.
A newt?
I got better.
Tell me, what do you do with witches?
Burn! Burn! Burn!
And what do you burn apart from witches?
All witches! Wood!
So, why do witches burn?
Because they're made of wood.
Good!
Oh, yeah.
So, how do we tell whether she is made of wood? Does a wood sink in water?
No, no.
No, it floats. It floats.
What also floats in water?
Bread. Apples.
Very small rocks.
Cider.
A great gravy.
Cherries.
Mud.
Churches.
Churches.
Lead.
Lead.
A duck.
Exactly. So, logically,
if she weighs the same as a duck, she's made of wood.
And therefore,
a witch!
A witch!
A witch!
A witch! Very good. We shall use my larger scales.
Remove the supports.
back rock.
Sad day. All right. When we conduct experiments, sooner or later, we're going to have to make a measurement. So we need a common way of expressing our observations as measurements so that everybody understands what we're trying to say. A measurement always comes in two parts. There's a number, and there's a unit. And they are inseparable. When you make a measurement, if you make a measurement without a unit, then it has no value. In other words, I could say, let's see, what am I? This is February. I'm not quite there yet. On the 25th of February, I will be 71. I didn't say I would be 71 years old, right? I could just as easily have said I'd be 71 inches tall. I didn't give you any units, right? So we just assume that I'm saying 71 years. But in science, we can't assume, right? You know what assume means, right? When you assume, it makes an ass out of you and me. So we don't make assumptions in science. So you need a number and what we call a scalar, a unit of measure. So if I say 1 foot and 1 inch, you know that those are different actual physical measurements. 1 inch would be like that. 1 foot would be like that. Right? So the unit matters. Other examples at the bottom are like 20 grams. Now, units of measure can also come in compound forms. This bottom one, 6.63 times 10 to minus 34 joule seconds, is a constant. We'll talk about that later, see it again later. But a joule second is a compound. Joule is a measure of energy. Second is a measure of time. And sometimes these measurements can be ejected from an instrument. And the instrument does its calculations internally and gives you that measurement in these terms. So what I would point out is, I may be jumping the gun. Let me hold off on that. I'll come back. Let's talk about scientists agree upon units of measure. So we have these fundamental units that are agreed upon and standardized in the international system, SI units. It's SI because that's French. They do everything backwards, System International. So for mass, the fundamental unit is the kilogram. Okay. For length, the fundamental unit is the meter. For time, second. For temperature, Kelvin. Don't be too upset about Kelvin because degrees Celsius is the same size as a Kelvin. Electric current is the ampere. We might not get to that one until, let's see. Yeah, we won't use this one until second semester. We will use this one, amount of substance, mole. A mole is a number of things, and we'll talk about that in more detail. Luminous intensity, the candela, we won't touch that one at all, so you can just forget that one. But these are agreed upon standards, and if it represents a physical property, then there will be an example, a sample that is the standard for mass, for instance. There's a standard mass in a cave in France in a double bell jar filled with argon gas. And there's a cylinder in there made out of platinum and iridium. That is the standard kilogram. So if you want to standardize your kilogram against that one, You got to send your kilogram to them. They will tell you what its true mass is and give you a report and send it back to you. The length, the meter, there's also in that cave, in a protective jar with argon, a platinum iridium bar. It's of a particular shape. A cross section of the bar looks like this. Oops. There we go. Cross section of the bar looks like that. The reason it's that shape is because temperature will not cause it to warp. But that length is standardized. And it's actually based upon the distance from the North Pole to the equator through Greenwich, England, the prime meridian. And they just take a fraction of that distance, and that becomes the meter. Fortunately, now we have instruments that will generate a meter length using laser light, right? So you can, if you've got the money, you can buy one of these things and it produces a standard meter anywhere you want it. The second had to be standard. Second was already in use before we came to this, the fundamental unit system. So we just had to say, okay, everybody thinks this is a second, so we just need to standardize what that second represents. Degrees Kelvin, that was also had to be standardized from previous. The amp is a measure of electric current, and it's actually a composite of a charge passing a given point for every second. Right? We'll talk about that one later. The mole had to be standardized also. It's a number of things, 6.022 times 10 to the 23rd things is a mole. Right, we'll cover that again later also. Now, those fundamental units may not be the right size for your particular experiment. Sometimes you need larger units as the unit of measure, right? And in that case, we use a prefix to the unit of measure. So when we travel from here to Charleston, it's like, 55 miles, depending on where you go. Let's make it easy, 60 miles. Right? So how many kilometers is that? That's in the neighborhood of 100 kilometers, roughly. That's probably more than that. It's probably 103 kilometers. Notice I didn't say meters. I didn't use meters because it'd be too big a number, right? So I use kilometers. The prefix K, kilo, means you multiply the meters times 1,000. That's what those prefixes do. They change the unit of measure based upon their value. So down here, kilo means 1,000 times, or 10 to the third. If we needed a more mass, we could say mega, right? A million times. Actually, interestingly, the fundamental unit for mass is the kilogram. So it's already got a prefix built in. It's 1,000 grams is a kilogram. Now, why did we choose the kilogram as a fundamental unit and not the gram? Well, the gram was inherited from medieval times, but it was too small, right? What would happen if you left a fingerprint on a standard, that platinum iridium cylinder, if it was only a gram? It would throw off the mass. Or if it corroded, by percentage, you lose your standard. So they decided, okay, we need a bigger one. So let's take, we've already got the gram, we can't do anything about that. We'll just say, 1,000 times. So let's make that gram 1,000 times bigger. That'll be our standard. So that's why the fundamental is a kilogram already with a built-in prefix. So just learn these prefixes. Let's see. You don't have to go to exa or peta. Maybe tera. Giga. Everybody knows what giga is. Right? Come from gigabytes of memory. Right? Giga is a billion, 10 to the 9th. Used to be megabytes was a lot. Right? When I first started in computers, megabytes. Now it's nothing. Terabytes now are common. Right? 10 to the 12th. And there are many servers stationed around the world that consume petabytes of information. Okay, so if we want to go smaller, we just go the other direction. We use a prefix that reduces the size of the fundamental. So instead of going big on the distance, say I want to go small. Right? I want to go down to something that I have to use a microscope to see. So that one would use the micro prefix, 10 to the minus 6th, 1 millionth of a meter. That's a micrometer. Or if you're wearing sports outfits that have built-in fibers, modern fibers, they might be nanofibers, right? They're on the order of a billionth of a meter in length. Okay, so learn what these mean. Like that's a tenth, centi is a hundredth, milli is a thousandth, micro is a millionth, nano is a billionth. Pico is a 10 to the minus 12, a quadrillion. Okay. So I want to make a point here. Our fundamental unit is mass. It does not change anywhere in the universe. Well, as long as you're not relativistic, as long as you're not near a black hole, or you're not traveling close to the speed of light, then mass is constant. But weight is not. Mass is a measure of inertia. In other words, that first law of Newton that said, things resist motion unless you push them, or things that are moving resist stopping unless you push them. That's a measure of inertia, and that's the mass of the object. So a greater mass means more inertia. But if you put that mass in a gravitational field, so you put it close to the Earth, right? It may weigh... for me, it may weigh 200 pounds. But if you put me on the moon, I'm in a different gravitational field. I've got the same mass, but now I only weigh about, let's see, what's 6 into 200? 2, 3, maybe 35 pounds. Okay. A sixth of what I weigh on the Earth. So that's the difference between mass and weight. Now, unfortunately, in my youth, I had weight ingrained into my brain. So when we go into the lab to measure out a mass of something for an experiment, I may tell you to weigh it. So just understand that I want you to determine the mass, not the weight. And our balances will take care of that for you. Okay, here's a very important topic. Uncertainty. Uncertainty is ubiquitous with every measurement. Every measurement you make means that you're not absolutely certain that the value that you've assigned to that physical object or whatever measurement is not exact. Since we appreciate that uncertainty accompanies every measurement, what we need to do is to understand it and control it as best we can. So when we write a number, say 3, 2, 5, 9, if I write that number, and for now we're not going to put any units on it, Now write that number. Every other scientist that sees that number, if I publish it, what they're going to see is I'm saying that these digits are certain and this digit is uncertain. I'm actually saying that's my best guess. You can rely on these, but that's a guess. Okay, that's what every scientist sees when they see that number. Now, what does that mean in practical terms? Well, here is an instrument that, let's see, are we going to use that one? Calorimeter, Boyle's law, constitution. Yes, we will eventually use one of these pieces of equipment in the lab. This is called a burette. It's designed to measure the delivery of small volumes of a liquid, usually aqueous liquids. So it's marked on its outside in milliliters or thousandth of a liter, right? So if we know what the size of a liter is, right, and we have an idea, we know what a liter bottle looks like. We know what a 2-liter bottle looks like. These are milliliters, thousandth of liters. And they're marked on the side of this one from top to bottom. So 0 milliliters is at the top. And as we deliver, we can go from 0 to whatever this one is, and we've delivered that much from our device. Right? What we want to do is say, how do we read this device to give us a number with certain and the last one uncertain? Okay. If there's a marking on that device, any of those markings are certain. So if we look, let's see, this goes from 20 to 21, so that's 1 milliliter. And then in between are 10 marks. So each one of those is a tenth of a milliliter. So notice, we've blown it up so we can see it better. 20 point, right? We're not to 21 yet, so it's 20 point, tenth of a milliliter. 20 point, one, but not 0.2. So 20.1 is certain, right? Certain. Uncertain is between where there is no mark. So what are we going to say? Well, when we read volumes in these devices, you read the bottom of the curve, the bottom of the meniscus, right? That's what this is, this meniscus. They're calibrated to read at the bottom. So that's, we could say 0.4 or 0.5. Right? Our example says 0.5. So our uncertain would be 0.5. 20.5 milliliters is what we say is the measured volume there, the delivered volume. So the certain values are those, and the uncertain is that. Okay? So we're still trying to get a handle on uncertainty. And when we make several measurements, we can express those measurements in two different ways. And typically, when we conduct an experiment, we want more than one value from the experiment. In other words, we may have to repeat the experiment several times. That's one way to minimize the effect of error, uncertainty in the measurement, because you get the several different measurements and you average them together, and that gives you a better idea of where the true value is. Well, we express those values in these terms. If we are saying that the value that we produce is very close to or in perfect agreement sometimes with the true value, or more often the accepted value, then we're saying the value is accurate. And we use this analogy. Say you have a target. With a bullseye, and you shoot, say, 3 rounds at it. If you're accurate, then the rounds hit close to the bullseye. Okay? If you're not accurate, they'll hit out here somewhere. Precision, on the other hand, which is often misused in popular media. When you say something is precise, you're saying that several measurements of the quantity agree with each other. In other words, the spread is very narrow. Now, I could say those three shots, if they landed here, here, and here, that's good precision because they're very close together. But it's very poor accuracy because it's far from the bullseye. Now, if you're a hunter and you're sighting in your scope before hunting season, you're going to go to a range at whatever distance you prefer, 100, 200, 300 yards, and take three or four shots at the target. And if it does that, that's good. Because now all you have to do is adjust your scope and you can bring that group down here. And you take, once you've made the adjustments, you take three or four more shots and be sure it's on target. If you do that, then you've taken precision and you've added accuracy. All right. Well, here's a dartboard. Now, if you've got precision and accuracy to consider, you can have precise and accurate at the same time. That's the C. We just showed you that one. You can have precise but not accurate, and we showed you that one too. You can have not precise and not accurate, because these are way off target, plus they're spread out. So they're neither accurate nor precise. The only one that's missing is not precise but accurate. Not precise but accurate would be something like that. If you average these together, you're on the bullseye. So we're saying the average of those values is accurate, but their spread makes them not precise. Okay. Now, we're still trying to get a handle. How do we deal with uncertainty? And not only that, but when we have to do calculations with two or more numbers to generate an answer, we need to take into account the uncertainty that filters through the calculation. How do we deal with it? Well, first of all, we've got to identify, and the method that we're using is called significant figures. First, we have to identify which figures are significant in a number standalone. Then we can say something about the calculation afterwards. So we're going to do the rules for significant figures first. All right. Rule number one, all non-zero integers in a number are significant. So 3, 4, 5, 6 has four significant figures. That's the easy one. Now, what do you have left? Now you've got zeros. What do you do with the zeros? Right? The way we write numbers, the Arabic system, zeros are placeholders, but they're not always significant for our purposes. If you have leading zeros that precede non-zero digits, they are not significant. And that usually is accompanied by a decimal point. So when we say 0.048, and by the way, this is one of my pet peeves. When you write a number,
If you write that like that,
it's wrong. That's what I call an orphaned decimal. Decimals on this end of the number, if there's nothing out here, you got to put a zero. Okay, back to the number. Those left-hand zeros are not significant. So this number only has two significant figures. Next, we move the zero to the right and put it between two non-zero numbers. Right? In that case, that zero is significant. It has to be significant because without it, this number would have no meaning. Right? It's a definite placeholder that must be preserved. So this number has 1, 2, 3, 4 significant figures. Okay? The last one is you have zeros to the right of non-zero numbers. In this case, the zeros are significant only if there is an explicit decimal point. So if I wrote this number and I put a zero out here, now it has 3 significant figures because there's a decimal. Now, in our example, if you write this one, we know that there's an understood decimal right here because this is the ones place, the tens place, the hundreds place. But for our purposes, if there's no decimal here, that zero is not significant. Okay? It only has 2 significant figures. Now, if we made that measurement and said, oops, that's supposed to be a significant digit, all you have to do is put a decimal there. Now, we can't put a zero out here like we did for this one because that would add another significant figure. So this decimal has to dangle. There's no way around it. Okay. Then there's one other class of numbers called exact numbers. These numbers are said to be infinite significant figures. In other words, when we do calculations later, the number of significant figures in an exact number has no bearing on the outcome. And these are usually associated with either conversion factors, which we'll talk about, or counting numbers, like 9 pencils or 5 fingers. Right? Those are exact numbers. Okay. Now, one other thing we need to deal with. How do you write very large numbers and very small numbers? Suppose you don't have the luxury of changing the units so that you can keep your numbers in a manageable size, and you have huge number measurement, or you have a very small number measurement. That's where exponential notation comes in. Now, your authors probably equate exponential notation with scientific notation. But there is a difference. Okay? Exponential notation simply states that you take a number that's not exponential and convert it into an exponential number, and the coefficient, or the number on the left, if we go from 300 here to here, I'm going to change it. Let's say we go to here. That's exponential notation. This is your coefficient. This is your exponent. And what we're doing is we're storing up size information in this exponent. In other words, we're taking that 10 and putting it over here. So that reduces this one to 30 from 300. And to check yourself, just multiply it out. What's 30 times 10? 300. Scientific notation requires that the coefficient has to be between 1 and 10. So
scientific notation would write it this way.
Okay. All right. So what we've done here is we've taken a large number and made a small coefficient with an exponent. Right. Notice the exponent is positive. That means this is 10 squared is 100. 100 times 3 is 300. What if the number were very small? Oh, before I leave this slide, we can reduce the size of the coefficient so that it's not, right, we could have a big number out here. Reduce the size of the coefficient so that it'll fit in a smaller space by using this method. And also we can preserve the significant figures in the coefficient. So this number has 1, 2, 3. It's got a decimal there. 1, 2, 3 significant figures. The coefficient has 1, 2, 3 significant figures. And so we preserve the significant figures in the coefficient. All right. I didn't mention if we have a very small number. I see 0.00340. Right? We want to write that in scientific notation. Well, if you move the decimal to the left and make the coefficient smaller, then the exponent has to get bigger. It has to go positive. Right? So make this smaller, make this bigger. Now we want to make this bigger. So the coefficient, so as the coefficient gets bigger, the exponent for your 10 has to get smaller. That means negative values. So we go 1, 2, 3. To the minus 3. We moved it 3 places to the right. That makes this number bigger. And this smaller. Okay? And to check yourself, just multiply 1,000th times this, and you get that number. Okay. Now that we know significant figures, we have to say, all right, how does that affect our calculation? Calculations come in 2 flavors. Multiply, divide, which is also exponents. Take something to the power is a form of multiply. Multiply, divide, or add, subtract. So the first rule, multiply, divide. If you multiply 2 numbers, or actually, if you multiply a string of numbers, the number of significant figures that you are allowed in the output is equal to the smallest number of significant figures in the multipliers. Right? So if we punch this into our calculator and say we get 7.381, we have to come out with only 2 significant figures, and that involves rounding. And we're going to use the simplest form of rounding there is. 5 or greater, we round up. Less than 5, we round down. Now, what do we round? Well, we need 2 significant figures. So we're going to go right here. Right? Okay. So that means we look immediately to the right of this number. 8 is greater than 5. So that means 3 becomes 4 and 8.1 drops. That's why we have 7.4. If we were going to round the number to 3 significant figures, we would look at the 8 and go just to the right. That's less than 5. So we drop the 1 and keep the 8. Okay. Now the add-subtract rule is a little bit different. Add-subtract requires that you line up the decimal points. All right. So if we have, I'll use their example. 24.45 and 7.83. Add those numbers together. We line up these decimals like that. And then we bring things down. 7, 12, carry the 1, and 3, 31.275. Now, where do we have to round in our answer?
We say, all right, we look
the uncertain digit that's farthest to the left in any of our numbers determines the length of the number in the answer.
So this one is uncertain. That one is uncertain. We keep this one. And we draw the line there. So this is 5. That becomes 8. 2, 1, 3.
That's how we add subtract. Now, let's see. I'm not sure if I have a slide. I've got a... There we go. No, let me go back and draw your call your attention to another possibility. Suppose we have, let's see,
5 and 1, 5, 0.
Okay. This one has two significant figures. It has an understood decimal there, so we line it up with this one. And then we add them together. Now, how many can we keep? Well, that's not significant. So we're stuck with this one. And we have to draw the line there. Right?
So that's 5. That means this one becomes 7, 3, 3.
But we can't leave that empty. Right? Because our answer is in the 3,000s, not the 300s.
So this one comes down as a 0. Now we have 3 significant figures in our answer.
We had in our operators, our numbers, we had 4 here and 2 there. And our answer's got 3. So when you add subtract, it's a mystery as to what the answer will have as significant figures. It's easy. Multiply, divide is easy because you just look at the least number of significant figures, and that goes to your answer. But the add, subtract, you have to do it this way, and the outcome is anybody's guess. Right? We went from 4, 2 to 3. Okay. So let me see. If you... here's an example. Let me see. I'm not sure how many slides I got left. If we were going to claim a volume by adding this one together with that one, what could our claim be? Well, if we look at this one, we can say this is a graduated cylinder, so it measures from bottom to top. That's 1 mil, 2 mils, 3 mils, 4, 5 mils. Each one of these is 0.2 mil because there are only 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 divisions. Right? So this is 1, 2, not quite 3. So it's 2.24689. It looks like 2.9 for that one. And this one is similar, only it's 0.2. 0.29. Let me see what I put in my outcome. Okay. We're saying 3. All right. So we're claiming this one is 3.0. We're claiming this one is 0.30. When you add those together, you get 3.3, but you're limited. Let's see. You know, that's right. You're limited. You're limited to this position. It's furthest to the left. So we have to chop it off there, and the 0 drops out. We got 3.3. So we can't claim 3.30 based upon this one. The whole point of this exercise is that the accuracy of your final volume is determined by the least accurate measuring device. And that would be this one.
Okay, when you're solving problems, what is my goal? Actually, I think it would be better to say, what's the question? If you don't know what the question is, you'll never get the answer. So, what's the question? And then you look at the problem and say, all right, what's given? What is given in the problem? Is that enough information to answer the problem? Because you may have to go outside. For instance, you might have to go to a periodic table and get some information off of that to finish the laying out your strategy for solving the problem, which is the last step. How do I get there? Some problems are very simple. One-step solutions. Some are pretty complex. So the strategy with a complex problem is to bust it apart into smaller pieces. Logical pieces that can then, when you get answers to the smaller pieces, you can put them back together and get the answer to the large, the overall question. All right. This is a big, fancy two words, dimensional analysis. Basically, what dimensional analysis is telling you to do is when you're making calculations with units attached, pay attention to your units. Because every time you make a mathematical calculation, the units are affected as much as the numbers are. So if I had 1 pound of force and apply that through, 3 feet. For 3 feet, then what I've actually produced is 3 pound feet. Okay, so the units are multiplied together just like the numbers are. So that's why we have pound feet over here. If I were to say, what's standard atmospheric pressure? I don't know if everybody knows this, but I'll use it anyway. 14.69 pounds per square inch. Right? Somebody had to measure that. They measured the force applied for a given area. And the product was this value with these units, pounds per square inch as an area. Right? We'll do calculations like that. In fact, it'll probably make better sense if we work some problems. Okay, many problems in chemistry can be solved using dimensional analysis. In other words, you know what the units are supposed to be for the outcome. You know what the units are when you start. So you put the problem together in such a way that gives you the outcome. Right? I put those in words, but a problem will answer it better. And in order to do dimensional analysis, we're going to use conversion factors. And I'll explain to you what a conversion factor is. A conversion factor. Let's start with a simple problem. Like I have 6.8 feet to go from my ball to the hole, if I'm playing golf. And I want to putt it in the hole 6.8 feet. How many inches is that? We want to convert that to that. If we look at the green, and we got a flag here, and my ball is, say, here, and it's 6.8 feet from the hole. Well, how many inches is that? Well, if we convert it to inches, is that going to change the distance? No. We're just using different units. Right? So what we want is in inches. How many inches is that? Right? So we need to find out how many inches equals that many feet? Right? There's your equivalence. That equals that. Well, we got to get from here to there. How do we do that? We got to find a way to cancel the feet. Remember, in an operation, if you have feet in the numerator and feet in the denominator here, they will cancel. So we need inches here because we'll keep inches. We'll cancel feet, keep inches. Right? That's a conversion factor. Now, why do conversion factors work? Well, if we want to go from feet to inches, 6.8 feet to inches, well, we can multiply that by one, right?
You can multiply anything by one, and it's okay. But that doesn't get us where we want to go.
So look here. 12 inches equals 1 foot. Okay? What if I divide both sides by 1 foot? Like that. Okay? I can do that. If you divide both sides of an equation by the same factor, then you haven't changed it.
So 1 foot divided by 1 foot is equal to what?
One.
So 12 inches divided by 1 foot is equal to one. Well, why don't we just substitute that in there, or better yet, substitute this one in there. So if we substitute that one in there, 12 inches equals 1 foot. Now we can cancel feet, leave us with inches. Okay, that's why conversion factors work, because every conversion factor is equal to one. Right, so there we go. And we find out that canceling feet leaves us with inches. And we have a distance of 82 inches to go. All right. We can do the same thing. We can actually string them together. Right? If we have a conversion factor, say I want to go from pounds to grams, but I don't know what the conversion factor from pounds to grams is. I can't use a single conversion factor. But each one of these conversion factors is equal to one. So I can multiply 4.5 pounds times one times one. Only this one is equal to 1 kilogram per 2.2 pounds. And this one is equal to 1,000 grams per 1 kilogram. Notice what we're doing. We're canceling pounds in the first step to give us kilograms. And in the second step, we're canceling kilograms to give us grams. This is what I call a chained conversion. We'll chain our conversion factors together and end up with our answer. Now, how do we get there? Dimensional analysis. We know the dimensions we're starting with. We know the dimensions we're ending with. The question is, how do we get there? We choose our conversion factors to cancel and leave behind, cancel and leave behind, until we get where we're going. All right, it's 3 o'clock. Okay, I got 45 minutes. Hopefully I got enough time. So here's a practical problem using conversion factors. And anybody who's taken a long trip in a car has probably done this, unless they're just filthy rich and it doesn't matter. But for those of us who have to budget when we travel, you need to know, how much money do I need to take with me to go from point A to point B? This example uses New York and Los Angeles. I usually calculate from Beckley to Atlanta, because that's where my family lives. But what do you need to know to get there? Well, there are several things you need to know. If you want to know how much money it's going to cost, first of all, you need to know how far is it, right?
So it's so many miles from point A to point B.
Well, if you're gonna work on the angle of determining how much money do I need, you're usually talking in terms of how much money do I need to buy gas.
So eventually you're gonna end up with a dollar sign. So one of these in here is gonna have a dollar sign on the top. We're gonna cancel miles, but we can't go directly from miles to dollar signs because we don't have a conversion factor for that. But we do have miles to gallons, right? How many gallons does your car use in a mile? Or how many miles does it go for each gallon, right? So if we know that, let's just pick a number. For every gallon, you can go, say, 25 miles. Right? That gets rid of miles and leaves gallons. Now we do have a conversion. So how much does gas cost per gallon?
Right. Last time I checked, we just have to take an average value because it's going to change from here to there. So let's just make it easy, $3.
Say it's $3 a gallon. Right. So that gets rid of gallons, leaves you with dollars. Now all we need to know is how far is it?
And we can find out how much money we need to carry to go from point A to point B, and then to get back, you just double it. And if you're going to do some driving around down where you're destined, then just tack on a pad it with 10, 15, or 20%. And then you're sure to have enough money to do what you want to do. Okay. Say we're going to make some measurements. Now we're sort of switching themes. We want to make some measurements of temperature. So we know if we stick our hand in a pot of boiling water, we know that's hot. Or if we dispense a cube of ice from the freezer and we grab it and hold it in our hands, pretty soon we say, that's cold. Right? So they're relative hot and cold. Well, the temperature of that object is fixed. What we need is a scale. Right? And depending on which scale we choose, the number that's associated with that scale might be different. There are three commonly used measuring systems in the sciences. Weathermen usually stick with Fahrenheit. All other scientists around the world use Celsius, and then some convert to Kelvin for specific reasons that we'll eventually cover. But we need to know maybe a little history about it, right? Where did these come from? Well, actually, they came in order. Fahrenheit came first, right? And they're named after the person that invented them. So Herr Fahrenheit was working with biological systems. And what he wanted was a fixed temperature, the high temperature, to be close to normal body temperature for most animals, which is 100 degrees. So he picked 100 degrees. This is where my thermometer value, my mercury, will rise to 100. And that'll be my 100 degree mark. And then he wanted a convenient way to calibrate his zero point. The coldest temperature that he could reliably produce would be distilled water and ice made from distilled water in mixture. As long as you got the ice, solid water, and liquid water together, and they're stable, then that temperature is zero. So he fixed his 100 and zero and then just subdivided it, 100 marks. Okay. Now we know that the freezing point of water is 32 degrees Fahrenheit and body temperature is 98.6. All right, so that's a difference of 66.6 degrees Fahrenheit. Well, Celsius came along, and what he wanted was something more closely related to chemistry, right? The physical world.
So he said, okay, my 0 degree is going to be the freezing point of distilled water. That's 0 degrees. Well, freezing water freezes, doesn't care what temperature is or what scale you're using. So 0 degrees Celsius is equal to 32 degrees Fahrenheit. And 100 degrees Celsius is equal to 98.6 Fahrenheit. Or 212 degrees. Well, we don't know what this temperature is. 212 degrees Fahrenheit is equal to 100 degrees Celsius. So 100 is way up here somewhere. So then he subdivided it in single degree jumps. Kelvin was more interested in a system of measuring temperature in which there were no negative values. In other words, his zero would be absolute. There's nothing colder than 0K. And we'll talk about why that is later. But he wasn't opposed to the size of the degree for a Celsius system, so he just used the same size. So that means if we know the relationship between negative Celsius degrees and 0K, then all we have to do is take that value and add it to K, and we get Celsius. And the value happens to be 273.15. So 273.15 plus 0 Celsius is the K value. Okay? Now, we need a way to convert from one to the other. Well, it's easy to go from Celsius to Kelvin. Kelvin is always going to be Celsius plus 273. And I'm just going to use 273 because that's good enough for any of the calculations we're going to do. It's a little more difficult to equate Celsius and Fahrenheit because not only are there 0 points different, the size of the degree is different. So we have to account for both, right? And here's the conversion from Kelvin and Celsius. And here's the conversion for Fahrenheit and Celsius. Now, I've got a, let's see, do I have it? No, I didn't post it. I had a link that described how this was derived. But as it is now, just memorize it. So Fahrenheit temperature is equal to Celsius temperature times 9/5, okay, plus 32. So what we're doing is this is compensating for the difference in the degree size from Fahrenheit and Celsius. And this is compensating for the 0 point, freezing point of water. Right? So if you know this, then you can solve it for C. And that's why this one is like that, right? So you do need to know a little bit of algebra. If you're not in algebra now, I hope you have taken algebra before. Because if you understand how to work algebraic expressions, chemistry will be a whole lot easier. Okay. This is an interesting question. Since they use different size degree marks, their slopes are going to be different, and eventually they're going to coincide. A logical question would be, at what temperature, what number is degrees Celsius equal to degrees Fahrenheit? There is a value, right? So all we have to do is say, well, if they're equal, then we say, okay, at that temperature, they have the same value, X. Right, so we just substitute X here, and solve for X. And that will tell us the temperature at which they are both the same value. Right, so here's what we did. Change it to X, solve for X. As it turns out, minus 40 degrees Celsius is equal to minus 40 degrees Fahrenheit. Okay, now, believe me, minus 40 degrees
in either temperature system is very cold. I used to work in a hotel and restaurant supply. We would supply dry goods, canned goods, meats, frozen goods, and some of the things we would freeze ourselves. And it's a well-understood principle that the faster you freeze something, the better it is when you thaw it out. So we put, when we made hamburger patties and the customer wanted them delivered as frozen, then we would take those hamburger patties on trays and roll them into a blast freezer. The blast freezer was maintained at minus 40 degrees Fahrenheit. And that's okay. I mean, if you just walk in and out, that's no big deal. But if you have to stay in there for a while, like I would have to do once a month, then I had the lowest seniority. So I got the privilege of inventorying the blast freezer. So once a month, I would suit up in my winter clothing, you know, big parka, big gloves, my clipboard, and a huge pencil that I could grab with my gloves. And I'd go into the blast freezer and count everything and mark it down. I'd stay in there for about maybe 12, 15 minutes, and I couldn't stand it anymore. I'd come out in the cooler and warm up. So it's very cold, very, very cold. All right, we're going to use a specific example here of a formula with unknowns and use those to relate this common expression of a physical property to a mathematical expression, right? So that expression is density. We abbreviate density with a big D. And density is simply mass of an object divided by its volume. Okay? Now, before we go too far, I want to say something about intensive versus extensive properties. If we make a measurement that depends upon the amount of substance, in other words, if the value that we express is bigger as a consequence of more substance, that is an extensive property. It's often called a capacity factor. So mass would be one of extensive properties. We would measure an object, measure its mass, and if it were bigger, it would have more mass. That's an extensive property. An intensive property is one that does not change with the amount of substance. An example of that would be temperature. So if you take my body temperature at 98.6, and you take the body temperature of somebody that's smaller than me, they might also be 98.6, right? It's an intensive property. It doesn't depend on the amount. If we take the mass of an object and we also know its volume, and we put the mass and divide by its volume, then we get a value called density. Now we've changed volume and extensive property and mass and extensive property into density and intensive property. Because once you know the density of an object, it doesn't matter how much of it you have, its density will always be the same. Okay? All right. So now we have a formula, D equals M divided by V. And it depends on the units of measure that go into the mass and the volume as to the outcome here, right? Because the units divide just as well as the numbers do. So in this case, we have a solid object that weighs 7.8 grams, It has a mass of 7.8 grams. And we've determined its volume to be 2.35 cubic centimeters. So we divide 17.8 by 2.35 cubic centimeters, and we find that its density is 7.57 grams per cubic centimeter. Notice that we say grams divided by cubic centimeters. Now that becomes the unit. And not always, but in many cases, intensive properties are ratioed units like that. Grams per cubic centimeter is one example. This is a solid object. If we had a liquid object, we may determine the volume as milliliters rather than cubic centimeters. Okay? So we would divide, in this case, we know what the density is. So we plug in the density. And we know what the volume is. We want to know what the mass is. So now we have an unknown. An equation in one unknown can always be solved. Right? So in our previous example, density was the unknown. In this example, mass is the unknown. Let's see. I lost my train of thought. The interesting thing is that 1 milliliter equals 1 cubic centimeter. Or in medical profession, you may see it written this way, 1 cc. Right? So if you've got a density of 0.85 grams per milliliter, it's also 0.85 grams per cubic centimeter, or cc. All right. Now, matter can, we're going to classify matter, its physical phase, as one of these three. There are several other possible phases for matter, but they're under usually extreme conditions. And for our purposes in chemistry, solid, liquid, gas will cover the whole gamut. And what we notice is that solids, right, let me make some room here. A solid has a definite shape and a definite volume. All right? We know that, probably know that from grade school. A liquid has a has indefinite shape. In other words, it needs a container. But it still has a definite volume. And a gas has an indefinite shape and an indefinite volume. Okay? Now, our example here is water. Water as a solid is ice, right? And it has a regular crystalline structure. And it holds its shape. So inside this Erlenmeyer flask, you see the cubes of liquid, solid water, ice. If we heat it up a little bit above 0 degrees Celsius, we get liquid water. Now the crystal structure is broken down and it needs a container to hold its volume. The water molecules are still close together, as they are here, although they're a little spread apart in the solid and not so much in the liquid. But when you heat it up above 100 degrees, you convert the liquid to a gas. And now the water molecules are very far apart and they have a lot of energy. They're moving very fast. Those are fundamental differences among these. Add energy here. Add energy to here. Okay. This just says what I've told you already. Solids are generally rigid with a fixed volume, fixed shape. Liquids have no specific shape, but they do have a definite volume, and they assume the shape of the container. And gas also assumes the shape of the container. But in this case, the container must be three-dimensional. It must be fully enclosed, whereas water, liquids don't have to. They can have an open interface. And a gas actually will expand to fill the entire container. Okay. Now, in this chapter, we're getting a lot of new terms, right? So use the crossword puzzle to help you learn these terms. Now, a mixture has to start somewhere, and it starts with pure substances. A pure substance is a material that cannot be separated into different substances by physical means. Examples. A pure substance could be an element, right? It could be gold, right? Solid gold. That's a pure substance. It could be a molecular substance. It could be a compound. It could be water. That's a pure substance. Right? It could be table salt. That's a pure substance. Okay? When we mix two or more pure substances together, we get a mixture. So let's say we're going to mix these two together, and we get a mixture. What is it about a mixture that's different from a pure substance? A mixture can be separated into its pure components by physical means. So what happens when we add salt to water? We get salt water, right? Gargle with it. But we can separate them. All we have to do is let it sit out on the counter and the water will evaporate. We didn't catch it, but we still have the salt left over, right? There's been no fundamental change in the identity of the pure substances. They're still water. They're still sodium chloride. Now, a differential for mixtures is whether or not the mixture is uniform throughout. In other words, you could sample the mixture anywhere and the percent composition of each of the pure substances would be exactly the same. Salt water is an example of a homogeneous mixture. A heterogeneous mixture is a mixture in which the parts are not uniform throughout. They have visibly distinguishable parts. A good example of that would be sand and water. Water mixed with sand. Right? Put sand in there and you mix it up really fast and you say, oh boy, that looks uniform. You wait a couple of seconds after you stop stirring it and the sand goes like that. So the mixture in different parts has different composition of sand in the salt in the water. That's a heterogeneous mixture. Okay. Let's see. Yeah. Okay. So let's see, can we determine which one of these is a homogeneous mixture? So we need a strategy for solving this problem. Well, Sometimes it pays to work backwards. We've got a list of things here: pure water, gasoline, jelly beans, soil, copper, metal. It may be advantageous to eliminate those things that are not mixtures, right? So let's eliminate pure water. That's not a mixture. Let's eliminate copper metal. That's not a mixture. It's a pure substance. Okay. Then we have these to choose from. Okay. How about a jar of jelly beans? If you've ever looked at a jar of jelly beans, you see concentrations of different colors here and there. So jar of jelly beans is not uniform. It's not homogeneous. How about gasoline? Well, gasoline is primarily a hydrocarbon called octane. But it also has other things in it. It has other volatile compounds and some less volatile compounds, and additives to help your engine run purely. Gasoline is a mixture, and it's a homogeneous mixture. All of those additives are soluble in octane. So gasoline is a homogeneous mixture. How about soil? So if anybody has ever been digging in soil, you know that as you dig deeper and deeper, you go through places where you see a change in color and sometimes a change in texture. Soils are heterogeneous. Take my word for it. My PhD is in soil science. So soils are heterogeneous. And there are people that make their living working with soil, what we call soil profiles. Okay, so the only one that's homogeneous in this whole group is a homogeneous mixture is gasoline. Okay. Now, at the very beginning of this chapter, I mentioned macroscopic observations. What do you see? All right. What you see could either be a physical change or a chemical change. Right? If it's a physical change, it may appear to be a new substance, but when you get down to the microscopic level and look at what it's made of, you find that the identity of the components did not change. So if we go from ice to liquid water, you still have water molecules in either one. Its identity did not change, but its phase did. That is a physical change. Now, if you have a mixture, you can take advantage sometimes of the physical changes in order to separate them. Right? So, if you're a moonshiner and you fermented your mash for a couple of weeks, now you want to get the ethanol or the drinking alcohol out of it, you can distill it. You just put your propane burners under the big tank, start it boiling, and you take the vapors off of it, run it through a copper coil, and actually you run it through a thumping barrel first, and then you run it through your copper coil for the vapors to condense, and then you catch the liquid in a jar. Now, if you're a reputable moonshiner, the first things that come off will not be drinkable. The first things that come off are methanol, among the more volatiles. So you throw that out. Otherwise, you're going to make your customers go blind. When the ethanol comes out, and you can tell by odor and by their shake test that you have ethanol, then you can start catching what comes out. That's distillation. A change in boiling point of the components in your mash will separate. So the ethanol comes off because it's more volatile at that temperature than water is. So ethanol comes out, leaves the water behind. If you have a particle size difference in your mixture, you can filter them. Say you have a suspension of something, say sand. You can filter it through paper, and the liquid will go through, and the solid will be retained. Right? A physical change from a liquid to a solid in a liquid. Chromatography is a special case, and it takes a lot of explaining. But look at the word. If you look at the word and say, what is the word composed of? What does it mean? Chroma means color. That's from the Greek that means color. And graphy comes from the Greek that means to write. So chromatography is color writing. And it's derived from the first chromatography, which was done on paper, of an alcohol extract of plant material. I can't remember the scientist's name, but the extract was dotted on the bottom of a strip of paper, like this, and then it was placed in a container with, say, ethanol. Well, as the ethanol is sucked up in the paper, it moves, right? It moves up there, and the mixture that is in the color, the extract, starts to separate into its components. Right? So they're always there, but we can separate them by physical means. A chemical change, on the other hand, produces substances that have changed their identity from the originals. So the example here is a Bunsen burner. We're going to use a Bunsen burner in, the second exercise, lab exercise 2. We're going to use a Bunsen burner. Bunsen burners take natural gas, mix it with oxygen or air, oxygen in the air, and ignite it. And you go from primarily methane, right, CH4, plus oxygen, right, and you produce carbon dioxide and water. So in a chemical change, you start out with these substances, and you get completely new identities in those substances. That's a chemical change. All right. Which of the following of these are examples of chemical change? Well, think about the identity. After the process, is the identity of its components the same? Are the identities of the components the same? Pulverizing rock salt. That's a physical change. You still got rock salt that you had before, you got it after. Burning of wood. Aha. Start off with cellulose and maybe some lignin and some ash. And you convert it into carbon dioxide, water, and the ash is left behind. That's a chemical change. If you dissolve sugar in water, have you changed the identity of the sugar or the water? No, not at all. Right? All you have to do is evaporate the water and you get your sugar back. How about melting popsicle on a warm summer day? The popsicle is still its components. It's a mixture, right, of water, sugar, flavorings, and colorings. And they're still there when they melt. So that's a physical change. The only chemical change is burning wood. You've changed the identity of the substances. Now, some people like flowcharts. And that's fine. If you start off with some type of matter and you determine that it is a mixture,
versus a pure substance. In other words, if it's composed of only one identifiable substance, either a compound, molecular substance, or an atomic substance, an element, then it's pure. If it's a mixture, then you got to say, okay, what kind of mixture is it? Right? Do I have visibly distinguishable parts? It's heterogeneous. If no, it's uniform throughout. It's homogeneous. If you have a pure substance, and you say, well, is it an element or is it a compound? Right? And a compound is simply a combination of one or more elements, different elements. So O2 is not a compound. It's a molecular element. But H2O is a compound. It's got two different elements together. Okay, that's what I mean by compound. So if you have elements, then you can make atoms out of them, right? But you can separate the atoms by physical means. But if you want to make elements from a compound, you need a chemical process. You have a chemical change to go from a compound to an element, or from element to compound. All right? And that's the end of chapter 1.